Hello everyone and welcome to the basic module of network security in Colibri. Here in the first part, I will start introducing what we're going through in the module. There is a part about to give you knowledge of common threats, including bots, spyware, adware, DOS and DDoS attacks, click for spam and information theft. This is actually what we went through in the introductory part, so I will not put so much attention on that. Secondly, knowledge of botnets. That will be the main focus here, and we'll be talking about the botnet lifecycle, botnet architectures, about how to track, detect and mitigate botnets. And then we'll talk about also the motivation and business models behind cybercrime with a specific focus on the botnets. The module is organized into four different presentations with four different themes. So the first is on botnets and what they can do. The second is on botnet architectures. The third is on botnet detection methods, and the fourth we continue with the botnet detection methods, but talk a little bit more about what are the challenges when we're doing anomaly detection and traffic classification. And we are already well ahead in the first part. So when talking about botnets and what they can do, I have this first slide, which is really to give you the text, but I will base my presentation on the picture that you will find on slide number 4. So a botnet is really that you have a botmaster who is taking control of a number of bots, which are also called zombie machines, because they are infected and often the user doesn't know that his or her computer is infected. But when the computer is infected, the botmaster has pretty much control of it and can be using it for a lot of different purposes. So that could be that he's using the computer for sending spam by email, that he's stealing information from the computer, such as banking credit card information or personal information from the legitimate user of the machine, or it can be used for DOS, for distributed denial of service attacks. The figure here is a pretty simplified picture where it looks like the botnet or the botmaster is taking directly control of the zombies. In reality, there are different architectures that we will also be having a look at, but often the botmaster tries to be some levels away from the real bots in order to make the botnet more difficult to track and more difficult to close down. Of course, it's important to say here that the user of some computer might not notice that the computer is infected, and often the programs, especially if it's a good or well-programmed bot, it's programmed to remain invisible and unnoticeable. But sometimes it can be sound like there is an increase in network activity when it is not expected. There could be an increased CPU load, for example, when certain malicious activities are carried out, and especially increased network load when certain malicious activities are carried out. For example, if there is a distribution of spam, you might feel that your network connection is working really slowly because it's really being overloaded with the spam. So there might be some signs, but often it's quite difficult to detect as a normal user. So we already looked at what it can be used for, like the spam, the email, the information theft. But actually it can be used in also other kind of cyber crime. For example, it can be used for installation of malware. So when the botmaster has access to a computer and control of a computer, he can install malware on that computer. It can be used for a click fraud. So the computer can be controlled to visit a web page and click on a banner. And if you have the control of 10,000 computers who go to this web page and click on this banner, then it starts to be a business behind it, and of course it's spam and DDoS attacks. Once a zombie is infected, it can also be used for multiple kind of malicious activities. So it might be that first some valuable activities are carried out. So first of all, you try to steal the information from the user. When you have taken everything that has a value, you can use it for a spam or for DDoS attack. Eventually it might be detected that the computer is infected, but at that time you have taken all things that has a value from it. In the introductory part, we had an example with Stefan and Elena Petrova, an example of a break-in to a net bank and how it works. Actually, I've taken the figure here again because I think it contains some very good information about how it works with money-related cybercrime. It's not only cases like the one with Elena and Stefan. It can also, another example is Nigeria letters, where people are talked into getting money transferred to their account. So transfer money to the victim's account, he will take out the account, take out the money and wire transfer it, for example, through Western Union in a way that is not traceable. But every time it's about how to break into banks or bank accounts, steal money from them and getting it out to the cyber criminal. So here in the figure, we can see the different steps that the cyber criminal is taking. The first step is to recruit the mules, which can be people that are paid for it. It can be people that are tricked into it, like Stefan was tricked into it, or people receiving Nigeria letters were tricked into it. Then in the second step, they establish their accounts, if they don't already have accounts. And in the third step, the cyber criminal do the break into the account, so he breaks into the web bank of some person, then he transfers it to the mules, there might be more, who are all getting small portions of it, and then they transfer it back to the cyber criminal through the wire transfer. So basically, that's the model. I will also say something about the roles when operating a botnet, because especially for the larger networks, it's actually really organized crime, which can also be seen from the model here. So if we start in the on the left side, we can see that there are a number of botnet customers. These are people who might have something they want to buy. So it can be the person who say, okay, I would like to buy 1,000 clicks on a certain banner. That's a click fraud. It could be that they want to DDoS attack a certain website. It might be the website of a competitor they would like to put down for 12 hours. Then they can buy that service. They might want to buy 1,000 credit cards numbers, and that's a service they want to buy. So these are the customers. They go to the botmaster and say, we would like this. The botmaster can then control this in his botnet. And trick here is, it's actually really easy to control a botnet. One way of seeing it is, there is a famous botnet called Zeus. Try to go to YouTube and then search there on tutorials on how to use Zeus, and you will be surprised of how easy the interface is, how easy it is to operate, the overview you have of the infected machines and so on. But the botmaster is really the one who controls the bots. He might not be specialized in distribution of malware. He might not be specialized in creating the malware itself, and therefore he might have the contact to other cyber criminals who are experts in these parts. So that could be a malware developer who is really expert in developing malware, or it might be a guy who is very good in distributing malware, and he can go and say, I would like to buy 10,000 infections on a specific customer segment or specific kind of computers or specific kind of platforms, and then the person who is experts in doing these infections is able to do so. So it's really a cyber criminal value chain which is quite well organized. In order to understand how the botnets are working, it's also good to understand the botnet life cycle, and there are different models. This is just one example of it. This is a five-phase model. Sometimes you have a four-phase model. There is a burst phase. In the burst phase, the botnet is developed, the malicious code is developed, and it can also be embedded into a convenient medium for transmission. There is an infection phase, where the malicious code is reaching the clients and installs itself, or for example using social engineering that we looked at before. There is a third phase, which is a communication phase. While the bot still doesn't do anything really malicious, at this point he's communicating with the botmaster and the command and control server, what we call the botnet infrastructure. in order to receive commands, or being able to receive commands. It can be an update software and so on, but it's still command and control communication. And then the execution phase, where you really have the malicious activity, like the stealing of information, like the sending of spam, like the participation in DDoS attacks. And then we have the disposal phase in the end, where the botnet is detected and removed from the client, or that for some reason it kills itself. But of course, you really want to be able to detect it early, and I would say that we often want to be able to detect it already in the communication phase before it starts doing anything malicious. But in the communication phase, often there is not much of communication because it's only a few commands with control traffic. It's not like you have a DDoS attack going on. It's not like you're sending spam. So this was the end of the first thing. Please finish this by taking the questions which are available in Moodle, and thank you very much for your attention.